former Muslim confesses that Islam is the religion of evil. Walid Shubat, an ex-Palestinian terrorist.
You see, my father was saved by a Jewish doctor because Arab doctors couldn't figure out what's wrong with him. Until today, I ask my Arab father, I ask him, why don't you pray for the Jewish doctor who saved your life? And his answer, simply put, is that I cannot pray for my enemy. But in a Jewish book, I learned that I must pray for my enemy and love my enemy, exactly as what she was saying. That's why the Jew knows love more than anybody else. That's why it's the Jew who will rescue a Muslim, a Lebanese, regardless of their religion, regardless of their background, in the hospitals. It was a Jew who saved my cousin, Ibrahim, Awadallah, who drowned in the Mediterranean Sea. When two other Muslims started to rescue him, they both drowned and died. A Jew comes by, and he takes empty gallons from the trunk of his car, swims towards him and rescues his life. But when I went to congratulate him for his life being rescued, and I mentioned to him that it was a Jew who rescued your life, I was instantly yanked out of the room and told and scourged, don't you ever mention that a Jew rescued his life. He hates the thought of a Jew rescuing his life. The question is, why do you still do it? Why do you still rescue us even though we want to murder you? Why do you hide your children while we put our children in the front to die so we can make propaganda? Why do we sell our children to the god Molech in terrorism? Why do we sacrifice our children for such a religion that teaches hatred? Why do we do it? Why is there so much evil in today's world?
Why indeed, Walid Shubat? Well, I suggest the first place to look is the Quran. It is very clear what it says there. Unfortunately, it is the thing that no one talks about. All you have to do is look at what it says. I welcome you, good morning, good evening, good afternoon, to the Booms and Bus Show. My name is Jonathan Davis, and today is Monday the 16th of October 2017. This is the weekly Booms and Busts Show. And I'm absolutely delighted to, again, have the opportunity to talk to you and discuss with you about free market capitalism, about cronyism, about socialism, about morals, about right and wrong, and also about making money so that we can hopefully have a more secure and comfortable retirement. Last week, were this a daily show, I'd be saying, on this day in history, well, I'm saying on this week in history, was the anniversary of the birth of the greatest Prime Minister the United Kingdom has ever had the luck to have as Prime Minister. Winston Churchill? No. Margaret Thatcher.
Where there is discord, may we bring harmony. Where there is error, may we bring truth. Where there is doubt, may we bring faith. And where there is despair, may we bring hope. To those waiting with bated breath for that favourite media catchphrase, the U-turn, I have only one thing to say. You turn if you want to. The lady's not for turning.
Be pleased to inform Her Majesty that the White Ensign flies alongside the Union Jack in South Georgia, God save the Queen.
What happens next, what, Mr. Knott?
Thank you very much.
What's your reaction,
Prime Minister? Just rejoice at that news and congratulate our forces and the Marines.
Of course, the chairman or the president of the commission, Mr. Delors, said at press conference the other day that he wanted the European Parliament to be the democratic body of the community, he wanted the commission to be the executive, and he wanted the Council of Ministers to be the Senate. No. No. No.
All levels of income are better off than they were in 1979. But what the honourable member is saying is that he would rather the poor were poorer, provided the rich were less rich. That way you will never create the wealth for better social services as we have. And what a policy! Yes, he would rather have the poor poorer, provided the rich were less rich. That is a liberal policy.
And we're very happy that we leave the United Kingdom in a very, very much better state than when we came here 11 and a half years ago.
And I well remember going on the anniversary of her birth to Grantham, the place of her birth, with a coachload. This would probably be about 3 years ago now, to see the buildings and experience what she experienced when she grew up. We saw her church, we saw her grocer's father's shop, and do you know what? A Prime Minister who allowed Britain to hold its head up high for the first time in over 30 years, only in the year or two before, got a really discreet little plaque on the corner shop, on the wall, saying this is where Margaret Thatcher, ex-Prime Minister of the United Kingdom, lived, and so on. And that's all it is. And it took raging arguments with the politicians of the great metropolis of Grantham. To finally agree to have the plaque. And they're still debating whether or not they should have a statue. Whether or not Grantham should have a statue for its greatest ever citizen that won a war, who defeated global communism, who turned the economic disaster that was the United Kingdom in the 1970s into the greatest economy in the Western world by the late 1980s, who made a rout out of politics in the UK and destroyed the socialist opposition, and was re-elected, rightly so, twice by the great British public. Why? Because she appealed to their sense of hard work, to their sense of right over wrong, to their sense of morals, to their sense that you shouldn't get something for nothing, and of course, to their sense that if you want to make money, the government should get the heck out of the way. And she rightly raised the living standards of every single person in the United Kingdom, except of those, of course, those who didn't want to take part. Instead, all they wanted to do was complain and watch whoever was Jeremy Kyle at the time. And they talk about the miners. I had this on Twitter last week from some total and utter numpty. I just muted the guy immediately. I've had the debate so often. Harold Wilson closed more mines than Margaret Thatcher. And even if he didn't, the idea that we should prop up failing businesses year after year is so nonsensical, which is why I have since day one railed against the bailing out of the banks. And if you haven't watched my speech on my website, the speech to the Freedom Association in March 2014, go and watch it. It'll be a very useful 11 minutes of your life. And still, total, utter numpties say that the reason why we have so many problems in financial markets, in the banking system, in central banking, in the housing market, it's because of Thatcher, isn't it? Thatcher! Well, first of all, to those who say such things, she hasn't been in power for 26 years, and she's been dead for some of those years. And with regards to the miners, have you ever been to what used to be mining towns? They are now green and pleasant lands, and, you know, all the miners had to do was retrain. All they had to do was learn how to plumb or be electricians or work in B&Q or whatever it happens to be. But the idea that those areas were financially decimated for the next generation is utter, utter balderdash. As everyone knows, all you have to do is go and visit them. And those who decided to just go on to their settee and drink beer for the rest of their lives and complain about Thatcher, it makes me sick. And then you've got the financial markets, the housing. Oh, it was Thatcher's fault, wasn't it? Right to boy, isn't it? Thatcher, right to boy. All Margaret Thatcher did was release aging, decrepit council housing stock into the private sector, and it allowed people to take pride in their circumstances, in their environment, and they themselves would then invest in that environment by planting flowers, by doing up the paint, by fixing the properties. In other words, getting the people to fix the problem. Oh, don't get me wrong. Thatcher and her cronies made mistakes. And one of the mistakes was that you were allowed to sell that ex-council house after, what was it, 5 or maybe 3 years. And of course, in the south of England, you made a whacking profit. Well, that shouldn't have been allowed. It happened. But the idea that it was because of Thatcher that we bailed out the banks, excuse me, is anyone seriously suggesting that Gordon Brown, who bailed out the banks, was a Thatcherite? And John Major, Tony Blair, who were consecutive prime ministers for, in fact, a total of 17 years, they were, of course, the liberal elite, and they were the ones in the space of less than a generation destroyed Margaret Thatcher's legacy. Thatcher left an incredible legacy. She fought all her life for what was right and what was in fact right. And she was proven right time and time again until her own people in the Conservative Party treated her like Julius Caesar and laid into her with knives and daggers in the Senate. I'll do a quick quote of the week from the great lady. There can be no liberty unless there is economic liberty. Margaret Hilda Thatcher, three times Prime Minister of the United Kingdom, first class in chemistry from Oxford University, 1925 to 2013. Now, when you go to Twitter and see the pinned tweet of this show, open it up and scroll down and you'll see some pictures and charts of what I'm talking about today. And there is a couple of pieces, headlines from newspapers. The first one is from that literary giant, The Sun. The headline is Facebook Rapists Caged. Two Afghan migrants who raped women for 3 hours while their mate filmed it on Facebook Live, are jailed for just 2 years. Can you imagine being that woman? In a room which no doubt had its curtains closed, which no doubt was away from anyone else. So like they said about space and terror, where no one can hear you scream. Can you imagine being that woman for 3 hours, being raped violently for 3 hours? And one of their friends filmed it and put it out onto the internet live. Can you imagine being that woman today? That shell of a woman. With the greatest emotional scar, psychological scar, that you could possibly imagine. And that is not even counting whatever physical harm came to her. Alongside that is from the Cambridge News. A Cambridge extremist jailed for 4 years for inciting racial hatred online. As it happens, the racial hatred was anti-Semitic, and he shared Hitler imagery. We note that his name and face are in the articles, but the Afghan migrants' faces and names are not, and we can reasonably assume that they're also Muslims. But that's not even the point. The point is, he didn't directly harm anyone. I'm not suggesting for one moment that what he did was anything less than savage, idiotic, gruesome. But tell me please, how they get away with 2 years for violent rape, three against one, and he does something online and he gets 4 years. I see that the Conservative Party which of course is like the Conservative Party of practically all time, except when you've got the likes of Margaret Thatcher running it and Winston Churchill, which of course is only about 5% of the time. The other 95%, you have those who are basically socialists wearing blue ties, and really, of course, they are cronyists, but cronyism and socialism are one and the same. I mean, because, as I say, you've got Theresa May, who pretends to be a free marketer, and then she talks about caps on energy prices. And you've got the Home Secretary, who is going to bring in rules to stop people from saying and doing hate speech online. Well, first of all, it is, of course, going to be the usual socialists and cronyists who will determine what is hate speech. Thus, if it's for free speech, if it's stating facts, if it's, however, against the liberal consensus, liberal with, of course, a small L, then you just know that that will be shut down and the, quote, perpetrators, unquote, will be hounded and prosecuted. Does anyone seriously believe that they're going to shut down and prosecute the hate preachers in the mosques? It is astonishing that in 2017 we now have 1984, exactly as George Orwell predicted in 1948. He and the likes of Brave New World's Aldous Huxley, they didn't dream the future, they forecasted it to an unfortunate T. And I despair for the future when I see all the dreadful things going on. The guy, what's his name, Paddock, who committed the atrocity in Las Vegas. Well, I don't know if you've seen the little 20-second video that's on Twitter of his room. Now, Las Vegas has got more cameras in it, and inside the hotel, they've got more cameras than even London, which is the most camera-infested city in the world, apart from Las Vegas. And his room, do you know what? Walk outside of the room, cross the 2-3 foot hall, and you've immediately got a staircase down. It's a way away from the lift. And guess what? There aren't any in that part of the hallway. Not a single camera. That's how they got all the guns up, and that's how they got all the guns down and left one guy. Have you noticed that? Have you actually seen? It's incredible that anyone who was in that vicinity that weekend has had all their photos and videos wiped from their cameras, their phones, I mean, just like that. In other words, somebody has found out who was in the vicinity at that time and has gone into every single phone and wiped the photos and wiped the videos. It's all on Twitter. These are the things that are happening, folks. And if you don't despair, then that's great. Keep taking the sauna. If you don't know what I'm talking about, go and check it out on Brave New World. Now, talking about cronyism, interesting kind of anniversary. Today, in stock market history, in 1992, Warren Buffett's company, Berkshire Hathaway, which is a public company, you can buy shares in it. In 1992, so that's 25 years ago, it broke $10,000 a share for the first time. And he'd been trading now for 30 years in Berkshire Hathaway. 1962 to 1992, $10,000 a share. And if you want to buy a share in Berkshire Hathaway now, 25 years later, you pay $280,000. So, many, many congratulations to long-term holders of shares, in essence, in the master full expertise of Warren Buffett and his partner, Charlie Munger. Oh, yeah? You know, Buffett and Munger will have you believe that they are the biggest free market capitalist in this quadrant of the galaxy. Yeah, the reality, Mr. Buffett, is that without your cronyism, you would be not even a shadow of what you are today. Because your investment in Goldman Sachs, in Wells Fargo, and all the other companies that you're invested in that make money because of bailouts, because of zero interest rates, because of quantitative easing, you wouldn't be worth, I'd say you're probably worth about $70 or $80 billion. Yes, you would still be an incredibly wealthy man. You'd probably be worth about $10 or $15 billion. And that would be appropriate. You would still be able to do whatever it is you can dream of doing. You'd be able to do it. The difference is, those in the bottom 80% who have been shafted by people like you and your friends in government, in the central banks, in the banks, etc., they would be richer and you wouldn't have taken money from them. I am a free market capitalist and I am delighted that there are supremely rich entrepreneurs in society, because they have got there normally by creating amazing things that lots and lots of people can use relatively cheaply and improve their standards of living. But they wouldn't be making as much money were the money more equally distributed. And when I say distributed, I don't mean by people in ivory towers. I mean by the invisible hand. And some of you were wondering, how on earth can a share price be $280,000? You've never heard of such a thing? Well, because he believes that there's just no point in continually dividing the shares and issuing, for example, 10 shares for one and immediately cutting the share price by 90%, because that costs money and it's frivolous. Well, yeah, I mean, that's fine. But that's the reason why you get $280,000 shares. And it's entirely possible at some point in the future, it could rise 300% and therefore go to $1 million a share. And why not? I'll tell you why not. Because it'll only happen through cronyism. Unless, of course, he buys businesses which benefits from the wonderful wealth and standard of living increases by the masses if you take away cronyism. And the prime example of that is housing. Kate Andrews, who is some officer at the Institute of Economic Affairs, a free market think tank, and it's run by free marketers left, right and centre. And you've got people there like Christian Nimitz and another crowd. I don't know who they are. I'm not really. And she wrote a piece which had enormous media bite. I think it was in the Telegraph or the FT or somewhere like that. I don't know. And their solution to the housing crisis is concrete over the green and pleasant land, which is England, or as it were, the United Kingdom, and build 1 million, 2 million, 10 million, a billion new homes. And apparently what that will do is reduce house prices. And it's true. The bankers, the economists, the politicians, the think tanks, the academics have come out with hundreds, possibly thousands globally, of paper after paper after paper, which says that if you build more houses, you increase supply, house prices will fall, and the downtrodden will benefit. Well, you'd think they'd be right, wouldn't you? And yet, there isn't a shred of evidence nowhere in the world at any time in history has a large building strategy brought down house prices. It's like the myth, socialism is good for the people, but it's never actually worked anywhere, anytime in history. I'll tell you what does work. Stopping liquidity. In other words, easy lending. It's beyond obvious. At the end of 2012, when, for that calendar year, house prices literally rose, 0%. And remember, it was only 3 years before that they'd had a 20-25% crash. They were still falling in Northern Ireland and some parts of the north of England. And with the bailouts, the QE, the 0.5% base rate, house prices surged in the southeast in the second half of 2009 and 2010, the first half of 2011. And then only in prime central London did they carry on rising. That's why by the calendar year 2012, there was a net no increase in house prices in the country. Even though we still had QE in the UK and globally, massively, and we still had, as it were, zero interest rates. So how is it possible that house prices weren't going up 25% a year? Because there was no demand. And why was there no demand? Because the banks and building societies knew that house prices were going to fall off the biggest cliff in history. So they didn't stop lending, but they put on very profitable mortgage interest rates, and they required higher deposits. Remember, by 2007, you didn't need a deposit at all. In fact, Northern Rock would give you 20% to buy a house. In other words, you borrowed 120% of the price that you agreed to pay. Of course, therefore, you were going to agree to pay blooming anything. The building societies and banks were making it more difficult to borrow. Therefore, there was no demand. Therefore, prices weren't rising. And what was going to happen next was that people who were holding on to housing, such as old people living in big five-bedroom houses on their own, who don't need those houses, held on to them. Held on to them for far longer than they might do otherwise because they were getting tax-free capital gains. Help to buyers were holding on to them and buying more because they were getting the capital gains. They were, in those days, making a little bit of a profit on an annual basis, but really not enough to make a buy-to-let profitable, but the capital gains did. And so George Osborne, David Cameron, and all the socialist cronies, and of course, at that time, they still had the Liberal Democrats in government, and that Marxist Vince Cable, and they brought out this astonishing Marxist concept of help to buy. Help to buy. All it was the government lending to people. If that isn't communism, the state lending directly to people, I don't know what is. So the banks and building societies would lend 75%. The government would lend 20% interest-free for 5 years. My word. And all you had to have was a 5% deposit. Well, of course, why wouldn't you have £25,000 for a £500,000 flat in London? Or £15,000 for a £300,000 flat outside of London? Or £10,000 for a £200,000 flat outside of the southeast? Well, of course you would. And if you didn't, you had the Bank of Mum and Dad, which of course is now the ninth largest lender. Oh my God. So, you know, all these young folk who are on the housing ladder, housing ladder, I tell you, listener, one day it will not be a ladder, it will be a snake, and it will last for 10, 20, 30 years. All those young people get involved in property, they've got no skin in the game. They haven't put down a single penny. They've borrowed the lot, or they've been gifted it from their parents. They've not got a single penny skin in the game. They don't care in the slightest if house prices go up or down. To them, it's just like rent. Well, one day, they're going to want to trade up from their one-bedroom or two-bedroom cardboard boxes. And they're going to get a massive shock. Oh, they're going to get a massive, massive shock. So, it's lending which gets and keep house prices high. And I give these people example after example of where building hasn't worked. And you had massive building in Ireland in the bubble up to 2008. You had massive building in Spain. You know, the stats in 2006 are absolutely incredible. And I've written about this so often and I've said it so often, and still these crony free marketers, again and again, will not listen to the facts. They are as bad as the socialists. in their contempt of reality, the arrogant people that they are. In 2006, Spanish house building for a population of about 45 million was greater than France, the Netherlands, and Italy combined. For goodness sake. And did house prices fall? Oh, you're shouting, they did fall. They didn't fall. Not in 2006. They didn't suddenly get massive house pricing in 2006. They had massive house pricing, house building in 2003, 2004, 2005, 2006. House prices kept rising. 2007, house prices kept rising. You didn't get the house price crash until the banks went belly up and lending stopped dead. The same in Ireland. Look at Australia. Look at China. Look at Canada. Masses and masses of house building. House price crash? No. Why not? Because every time there's a pause in house prices, they release more lending. And there's another example of house prices crashed, but only when the bank stopped lending. Ha! The subprime mortgage collapse in America started in 2006 and eventually by early 2008, the banks were crashing. That's when you got a 50% fall in house prices. And the difference between America and Britain is that they repossessed. We didn't. We allowed people who couldn't really afford to stay in those properties and certainly were massively in negative equity. You know, in 2007, you borrowed £300,000 on a £300,000 small house or flat, and by late 2008, early 2009, house prices were for that £300,000 were down to £250,000 or £225,000. You were massively in negative equity. But the government and the central bank, Bank of England, did an absolute disgusting deal for political purposes, obviously, with the lenders. And they said, we'll bail you out so long as you perform forbearance. In other words, bear with us. We'll make sure house prices rise again so you don't have to foreclose on repossess all these people. And if they had repossessed, they would have repossessed something like, I would estimate, a couple of million homes. But they didn't. And you've got the luckiest people in the world. And certainly, who the luckiest of all are those who were on very low mortgage rates, base rate plus X percent. Base rate plus 0.5%, base rate plus 1%. So for the last 8 years, they've been paying around about 1% on their mortgage. And many people have interest-only mortgages. They, even today, they don't have capital and interest mortgages. So all they're doing is like paying rent to the bank. On a £250,000 interest-only mortgage at 1%, they've been paying only £200 a month on the mortgage, reduced from, if it had been a capital interest mortgage, reduced from probably around £1,000 or £1,200 a month. And I'll bet we all know people who for the last 8 years haven't put a penny into their mortgage. And they've simply been paying money to the bank month after month, year after year, still owing all that money. And the bank is just waiting. You think the banks don't want a house price crash? I've got news for you. They're desperate for a house price crash. Why? Because there will not be forbearance the second time. And the banks will foreclose by the tens of thousands. They will take your properties and they will become the biggest owners of properties ever. And yes, what you'll do when you're repossessed is you'll go to the council and you say, I need a property. And what will they do? They will go to the bank, and whether they keep you in the same property or a different property, I don't know. But who is going to rent those properties to the council? Well, the banks will set up trading companies, property owning companies, letting companies. This is banking, folks, not charities. They are for profit, maximum profit, not every year, but yes, about 19 out of 20 years. And they are banks. They are everything you hoped they wouldn't be, but that's exactly what they are. Just final point on economics. I want to mention this chart that I've got there, and it shows real interest rates. In other words, the interest rate vis-a-vis inflation rates across the world. And it's basically for the top roughly 50 countries, because of course there's 20 odd in the Eurozone. And there's the chart. And it shows actually that little old United Kingdom has the lowest interest rate in the world relative to our inflation. In other words, the lowest real interest rate in the world. Oh, I beg your pardon. I'm just looking down. Turkey is even worse. And we know how much of a basket case Turkey is. Have you seen their currency? I think I'm right in saying their currency has gone down about 75% in the last few years. You want to know why sterling is hated? You want to know why sterling has gone down from $2.10 in 2007 to $1.20 by the end of last year? It's because relative to our inflation rate, we have the lowest interest rate in the world. The Eurozone is at minus 1.9%. We're at minus 2.7%. America is at 0.9%. So they've got a negative real rate, but not nearly as low as ours. Thus, you should be more inclined to buy the dollar than the pound. That's just in general terms. As it happens, the pound is on a rising trend and has been for about a year. And indeed, the pound is going to strengthen quite well still. It's currently $1.33. As I say, it's been down to $1.20. It was there back in January of this year. So it's gone up 10% against the dollar in 8 or 9 months. And indeed, it's rising against the euro as well, which means that it's rising against the two biggest currencies on the planet. But big picture, so long as the UK always has a significantly higher inflation rate than our interest rate, we're just creating more and more inflation. Very interesting chart, that. You should have a look at that. Greece, I tell you, Greece is going to be a gold mine. If you're not in the Greek stock market, you're not doing it properly, guys. The IMF raises the growth outlook for Greece to 1.8% for 2017 and 2.6% for 2018. The IMF reckons Greece will grow 2.6% next year. Forget, as I've told you before, forget everything you think you know about Greece. Forget it immediately. The Greek stock market, huh, crazy. It's beautiful. It's a beautiful thing. Gold mine. My God. Total gold mine. Now, on the subject of markets, I actually only want to talk about gold. I talk about gold every week because it's of interest, and I'm not a gold bug, but it's kind of interest. We're up to $1,305 an ounce, or we were just as I started recording this afternoon. In fact, I can go and check exactly what the price is now. Just give me a second to go on there, change that from a G to a U. I was on silver, I'm now on gold, and it is 1304. Okay, so it's just over $1,300. And if it can hold there, then, and if we can, in fact, if gold miners, should I say, can get up above the September high, so GDX, the gold miner index, is currently at 23.8. If it can get up to above 25.5 and stay there on the week, then gold miners are hot to trot. Gold is going to retest the summer 2016 highs. Gold miners could go up 50% within not a long time, several weeks or a few months. A retest of the 1370s would mean basically something like the 1350s or the 1360s. At that point, we'll review. But yes, there is strength in the gold markets, but you need to follow what the dollar does to the yen. If the dollar falls against the yen, then the gold markets are very likely to rise. Is there anything else that I particularly want to talk about? The dollar itself. If the dollar is strengthening, then commodities generally are falling. If the dollar is weakening, then commodities generally are rising. Yes, the dollar fell last week on good volume. We'd need to see the dollar fall again this week to have some expectation that gold was seriously inclined to grow. No, there's the agricultural. Yep, going great guns. It's going to be amazing over the next 5 or 10 years. Uranium miners going to be amazing over the next 5 or 10 years. Lithium, there's an ETF for lithium companies, probably amazing over the next 5 or 10 years. Had a great run, maybe needs to cool down first, but, you know, sort of thing, you just buy it and put it away. Rare earth metals, again, fantastic. Buy them, put it away, forget about them. Emerging markets, India, Russia, buy them, put them away. Frontier markets, Nigeria, Mexico, Vietnam, buy them, put them away, forget about them. If you're not doing these things, you're not doing it right. And if you're making 3 or 4, 5, 6% per annum and you think you're doing okay, you are not doing okay, because every circa 10 years, they take 30% away. Look at the last 20 years in the equity bond portfolios. Ask your financial advisor, wealth advisor, stockbroker, financial manager, portfolio manager, whatever you call them, ask them what they've actually achieved. Get them to get a chart out of actual client returns over the last 20 years. You'll see 2000, 2002, down 30%. Then up 2003 to 2007, and then 2008, down 30%. Then 2009 to date, up. No question, but every 10 years or so, they take 30% away. And that then leads me to Little bit more quotes of the week. And the first one is a cracker from the great W.C. Fields. Remember the guy, big bloke, with a trilby or a bowler hat, whatever it was, and a big massive cigar. Somebody forgot the corkscrew, and for several days we had to live on nothing but food and water. Great line. And a great free market capitalist thinker, academic, speaker, and spreader of the word, Murray Rothbard. It is easy to be conspicuously compassionate if others are being forced to pay the cost. Isn't that the truth, Murray Rothbard? Send me an email to jd@theboomsandbustsshow.com and I will put you on the list for the Booms and Busts report. You really should have it. I don't let your email or name leave this office. There's no junk mail. You should have the Booms and Busts report. It'll get, there's a lot of information there. And if ultimately it's not for you, simply unsubscribe. It'll cost you nothing. I would please ask you to retweet the pinned tweet of the show. Let other people know that you've listened and you want other people to hear what you're hearing. And indeed, I'll put the link to the iTunes page. I'd really appreciate it if you would star rate the Booms and Busts podcast. It is the 16th of October. I'm off for what we call in the UK half term, which is basically the late October school holidays, halfway through the term up to Christmas. We're off to North Wales. I'm so looking forward to it. It's going to be such a great time. We've got friends from France coming over, and hopefully we'll have other friends who live in North Wales who come over and spend the day with us. Going to have a fantastic time. I will therefore not be back on the 23rd of October. However, I really look forward. I hope to be back on the 30th October. Until then, have a great week.